So the next case, Kevin Maddox versus M. Elliott Spearman, is set for oral argument. And if the lawyers are ready, you may begin.
Good morning, everyone. May it please the court, Devin Hine from the Office of the Federal Public Defender on behalf of petitioner appellant Kevin Maddox. Mr. Maddox's trial, the prosecution struck seven of eight black potential jurors, leaving only one black juror to sit on the trial of two black men. Throughout the proceedings, Mr. Maddox objected that there were Batson violations, but the trial court said both that it was denying his claim at the prima facie stage, but also took pains to note the prosecution's reasons for his strikes, as well as his demeanor as judged by the court. The Court of Appeal on review took a different tact and said that it was also affirming that denial at the prima facie stage, but based on reasons it had selected from the record. This is in direct contravention with numerous cases from this circuit acknowledging that it is clearly established federal law.
Ms. Hine, I just because of your time, I want to go ahead and get into some of the questions that I have, at least. And I understand that you are arguing that we should not defer to the California Court of Appeals decision under AEDPA, but I was trying to figure out, so are you arguing that the state court decision is contrary to Batson or an unreasonable application of Batson?
See, it's both. It's contrary to Batson in that numerous cases, I believe Curie, I've cited at least Curie and one more, say that it is not in keeping with Batson to use reasons from the record to deny a claim at the prima facie stage. And this is something that has been addressed directly because it's part of a process the California courts have developed that has had to be addressed by the court because it does not conform to the Batson principles regarding step one. So that's both contrary, so it's contrary to Batson, but even if it weren't contrary on those grounds alone, given the overwhelming statistical data here and the numerous cases saying that numbers are sufficient to, at the prima facie stage, at least get you to step two or three, it also would have been an unreasonable application.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead, Judge.
So the implications of whether the California Court of Appeals reasonably applied Batson or if their decision was contrary to Batson, there's a lot of ripple effects in the case, however that's decided. So the state has recently filed a 28J letter, and they assert that the prima facie case really isn't an issue anymore, and that what we're really focusing on is the third step of Batson. But what they don't argue is what that means, because I think the argument in the briefs was that the California court's application of Batson was unreasonable at the first stage, the prima facie case stage, because it wasn't clear whether the court applied Batson or California law that had been since found to be unconstitutional. So what I'm struggling with is, what does this mean? If we were to agree with the defendant appellant that it was unreasonable, the California court was unreasonable at that stage, what does that mean for the other stages? AEDPA deference doesn't apply. Is that good? Carry through to all the other stages if only stage three is at issue? And also, does it mean that Cullen versus Penholster and its limitations on evidentiary hearings doesn't
correct apply? Your Honor. So first I want to talk a bit about what Hernandez was about. So Hernandez was a pre-EDPA case talking about direct review. And so on direct review of a lower court appeal, that opinion that wasn't clear on whether it was reaching step one or three, the court had no reason to start at step one because that court appeared to have gotten to step three. Here, the California Court of Appeal was adamant that it was not going to step three. It both said it was denying based on a prima facie, at the prima facie stage, and said, based on that denial, we are not reviewing the adequacy of the prosecution's reasons. So really the trial court nor the court of appeal actually reached step three. I believe what the trial court was doing when it put the reasons on the record and observed the prosecutor's demeanor was meant to preserve those facts for review in the court of appeal, but it's not the same thing as reaching step three, and I don't think that they did. So I don't think Hernandez applies, both because it's pre-AEDPA and doesn't really explain the very question you asked about, but also because the state court was adamant that it did not reach step three. And that also means there's nothing to defer to at step three, perhaps except that factual observation regarding demeanor, which I'll say, you know, this is a prosecutor who this court has taken the pains to publish an opinion saying has discriminated in the past. And that same prosecutor went before all of those courts before and had his demeanor observed. So I think that's one factual finding that is entitled to whatever weight you give it, but it comes with that caveat. And other than that, there's nothing else at step three that we would defer to because the decision was step one.
Go ahead. Oh, I'm sorry. I was just going to ask you about your statistical analysis. And one of the gaps in the record is the race of juror 3232. And there's you argue a comparison of that juror with juror 8913. Mm-hmm. But we don't know the race of juror 3232. And I think the parties acknowledge that that juror could be the one female Black juror who was seated. Do you think we can do the statistical analysis or compare the questioning of the jurors without that information?
I think that we can, and that Mr. Maddox can prevail if we do, because there are so many other jurors who were seated or not seated that have not necessarily disparate questioning as in the number of questions, but certainly disparate application of factors the prosecution alleged were its reasons for striking people. And on gang familiarity alone, it's not just 3232, though 3232 did blatantly say that she would be more sympathetic to gang members, while 8913 said he was not sure one way or the other. But juror 2431 also said that they have cousins and friends who were gang members, and it was never addressed by the prosecution again, and they served. There are other factors such as hardships, right? There are several jurors who claimed hardship and were allowed to sit, while Black jurors who claimed hardship were stricken. So I think we can prevail on the current record, but we certainly could not deny without a hearing.
And so if there was a hearing, I'm curious about if there is a hearing, how does that work in practical effect? And what if there is ultimately no way to determine the race of these individuals? Where does that leave the court?
Well, we have reason to believe that there is a way to do so. And just to be clear, I know that my opposing counsel said that we were not diligent in getting this information, but the California State Court has a process that requires a showing of good cause. And so the ordering of the hearing would be the first step that allows us to go and seek that juror identifying information. That might also be the stage at which we would look at the prosecutor's notes, and that might also give us more intelligence as to the race of the jurors if that was taken down in those notes, for example. But if we do not find the races of jurors, I think that we can still, looking at the questioning overall, not just towards 8913 and 3488, find that there's enough evidence to show that there was discrimination here.
And you talked about...
Yes, I have.
Go ahead, Judge Malloy.
Well, I just have a question, and that would be under the Batson challenge. Is the race of a single seated juror, is that dispositive of any kind of comparative analysis that might occur?
I'm sorry, I'm not sure I understand the question. Could you... Do you mean
is the race of a single seated juror dispositive of any comparative analysis under the Batson challenge?
Well, I suppose it would be if we don't, it would be important to know how that person was questioned. And so it wouldn't necessarily be dispositive, but it is, it would be hard to say that you've looked at the entire record and the questioning of the Black and non-Black jurors. We don't know which are Black and which are non-Black.
But all you need is one juror.
Correct.
To show one juror, to show structural error. Is that correct?
Correct, Your Honor.
I don't know if that's Judge Malloy's question, but I just wanted to reconfirm that.
And I apologize for not asking for time for rebuttal, but I see we're over now, so.
No, we've taken you a little bit beyond time, and I'm about to take you a little bit more, so I'll try to equate the time for so it's fair to everybody. But Ms. Hine, I guess let's focus a little bit on 2431. If you could do just a brief comparative analysis of juror 2431 or the questioning and why you think there's a case there with 2431.
Sure. So juror 2431 claimed hardship due to being a business owner who had no other income and three dependents. So that's one issue on which she was allowed to serve, but other non-Black jurors weren't. Further, her father-in-law was a defense attorney and husband had taken the bar. So she had familiarity with the law, but not necessarily on one side or the other. Her aunt was the victim of a robbery murder. So she was a person who had been a victim or knew a victim of a crime. And she also said that she had cousins and friends who were gang members. Turning to juror 8913, he's a lobbyist. He has a cousin who's an LASD detective and a cousin who's a gang member. And he had also had a family friend who was recently a victim of a crime. Now, I know that the prosecutor made a great deal out of this theoretical sympathy towards gang members, and also because he had, I think, given money to a person who was incarcerated, a family member who was incarcerated, but yet another juror actually visited a person who was incarcerated. So I think that it's overstated that juror 8913 did anything to indicate he might show any particular sympathy with regard to gang members. He simply intelligently answered questions that were directed to elicit bias from him by saying he would not show bias.
So at step three, determine if there's purposeful discrimination, we look at the comparative analysis, the questioning, and then we also apply the statistical information, and then the history of the prosecutor. Is that correct?
Correct.
If any,
all of those things are relevant.
And then to help us determine whether or not there's purposeful discrimination beyond by preponderance of the evidence. Is that correct? Is that
correct. The preponderance. Well, whether race was a substantial motivating factor in any strike against, in this case, a Black juror, Black potential juror, by a preponderance of the evidence.
All right, and then, so, and I'm gonna take you again over your time, and I'll try to accommodate that for Mr. Thakor, but I'm curious about juror 3232. Mm-hmm. It seems to me, I know you have argued that that also should be a juror that we should consider with respect to the comparative analysis. But is it juror 32's factors somewhat distinct, in particular because she served on a hung jury before, and also because she had been accused of a crime falsely, apparently?
Okay, I'm sorry. I think we're talking about different numbers. I believe we're talking about 3448.
You are correct. I'm sorry.
It's quite a large record without lots of distinguishing factors. So.
Yeah. You are correct. I'm sorry. Yes, that's
okay. Yes, I think we should talk about her as well. So she was on a hung. She was on a hung jury, which by itself. Actually, I want to step back for a second because I think it's important to remember that at step three, a prosecutor stands or falls on the reasons he gave for his strikes. So it's not just whether or not there are good reasons for strikes, but whether or not the reasons he gave were stand up to the record. And when you give a laundry list of reasons as he does here, and you can chip away at several of them, that also indicates or points towards discrimination. So yes, she was on a hung jury, which might be fine in and of itself as a reason to strike a person. But when you look at the conversation they had about her hung jury and you know, opposing counsel describes it as though she couldn't say why the jury hung. We don't have those kinds of conversations, right, during during voir dire. What she was asked was whether she thought people were unreasonable or not. She said both. Again, not showing any sort of bias, just trying to answer the question. She also was a victim of spousal abuse. So again, you know, when the prosecution says that, or here the prosecution never gave reasons for not striking people, right? We don't have those yet. But the theory that one would be a good juror because they are a victim of a crime, she was a victim of a crime herself. And it's very important that the idea that her neighbor was an ex-gang member was something that the prosecutor chose to hang his hat on, a neighbor that she didn't even express any affinity towards, that he never gave her an opportunity to explain one way or the other. So again, when you look at a situation like that versus one of 3232, it begs the question of what kind of juror can have a connection with a gang member and what kind cannot.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if anybody else has any questions. Not, and I'll give you a few minutes for rebuttal. Thank you, Ms. Fine. All right, Mr. Thacker, if you could state your appearance, please.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court, Deputy Attorney General Shahzad Takor for Respondent Appellee, the Warden. I think it's prudent for me to just briefly discuss the implication of Hernandez, given how recently I submitted the 28J letter. Whether petitioner made a prima facie showing at Batson step one is actually a moot point in light of Hernandez. And in Hernandez, the Supreme Court stated that once a prosecutor has provided reasons for his peremptory strikes and the trial court has ruled on the question of purposeful discrimination, the issue of whether a defendant has made a prima facie showing becomes moot. And that's exactly what happened in this case. The trial court indicated that the prosecutor's reasons were not pretextual and not indicative of discriminatory intent.
Yeah, it was a little bit different here. It seems like Hernandez may be distinguishable, but I want to give you a chance to further explain that, because here the trial court made an express finding that there was no prima facie showing at Batson step one. Isn't that correct?
That's correct, Your Honor, yes.
And it doesn't appear, I mean, it looks like you said, to the prosecutor, well, I'll let you for the record make go ahead and make a record regarding your reasons. And so not sure that the court actually reached step three here, but you say that he did?
Yeah, our position is that he did. And the specific language, again, that I would point the court to is talking about how the reasons were not pretextual and not indicative of discriminatory intent.
But how does that help you if because here the state court decision only reviewed the prima facie showing at Batson step one?
Right. And I want to be clear, Your Honor. So in light of Hernandez, if the court agrees and finds that the step one issue is moot, it's not necessarily helpful to us. That's not why I cited it. I cited it because I think it applies in this case particularly.
I think it may hurt you more than it helps you, actually.
I understand that, Your Honor, because in the consequence of applying Hernandez in this case would end up being that the court should proceed to the step three inquiry and review it de novo. And
that's right. Well, let me ask you if we could go, or I don't know if you have anything else on that. I wanted to get into the juror comparative analysis.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Can I ask him one question about Hernandez?
Yes, of course.
If we apply Hernandez, what does that mean with respect to potentially remanding for an evidentiary hearing? Does that have any impact on whether there should be an evidentiary hearing?
No, Your Honor. And it's for the same reason that the district court concluded. By referencing the existing state court record, we can already resolve this claim at Batson step three. That's exactly what the district court did. The district court conducted a de novo review of the record and under step three concluded that the petitioner has not fulfilled his burden of proving purposeful discrimination. And the law is well established that when you can reference the existing state court record, there's no need for an evidentiary hearing.
But we're not precluded like we would be if we were applying deference under Cullen versus Penholster. I mean, if this is de novo review, federal courts can have an evidentiary hearing. Is that correct?
I agree with that, but the law also states that where reference to the existing state court record can resolve the claim, that a evidentiary hearing is unwarranted. And I would also point out, Your Honor, that the only thing that's really missing in this case is which one of the impaneled jurors was the Black female impaneled juror. And I, given the jurors that are being used for comparative analysis in this case, given that they're not similarly situated, I don't see how finding out which juror was the Black female impaneled juror would end up aiding petitioner's claim at all. Perhaps that's a good segue to your question, Judge Murguia, about comparative juror analysis in this case.
Yeah, it appears the California Court of Appeals and the district court did not evaluate Mr. Maddox's proposed comparisons to seated juror 3232. And I'm just curious about that. Do you know why that is the case?
It seems to me that that's just that juror wasn't brought to the court's attention. And this is the first time petitioner is pointing out that juror 3232 should be compared. But like I said, juror number 3232 isn't actually similarly situated to the challenge jurors, juror 3488 and 8913. And the reason she's not is, although she indicated that she may have possible sympathy toward gang members, the only reason she was even talking about gang members in the first place is because her boyfriend was killed by a gang member. That's a pretty significant reason why the prosecution would have wanted to keep her around in this case, but not keep around someone like juror number 8913.
But I mean, it seems like it was in response to the defense counsel's questions that she stated, you know, I agree with you, but it was in response to the counsel's questions that her boyfriend had been murdered by a friend who was a gang member. Mm-hmm. And she testified in the trial, which was ongoing. But in that response, from what I understand, she says possibly gang members are people like you and me, people who really need love, and they grow up in neighborhoods, and it's a way of survival, a way of life. I'm not saying that their actions are justifiable, but it's understandable. And that's a pretty strong statement and sympathy of gangs. And just trying to figure out, based on what the deputy DA did here in stating, you know, why other Black jurors should be dismissed because of that sympathetic statement, why that doesn't factor in here.
I think it does factor in, Your Honor, but I think just like with people, you're not just one set of experience or one set of opinions. You're a full, there's more than one thing to consider. And for the prosecutor, that would have been not only these statements about possible sympathy toward gang members, but also the fact that she had gone through this experience where her boyfriend was actually killed by a gang member. She testified in the preliminary hearing and she was still awaiting trial in that case. And that kind of suggests some commitment to the criminal justice system. And so that's something that the prosecutor certainly would have found alluring. Whereas I think if you look at juror number 8913, you know, the nature in which he talked about gang members was a lot different than the way that juror number 3232 talked about it. Your Honor mentioned how juror number 3232 expressed that gang members are just like you and me, that they need love. But the way juror number 8913 talked about gang members was more as if he had an intimate knowledge of gangs. He talked about how his cousin was a player in a street gang. He talked about growing up around gangs, how that would impact his outlook in the case. He mentioned a specific notorious gang member by name. And so I think the way in which these jurors talked about the gang members and their feelings about gang members was certainly distinguishable.
Yeah. What weight do we give our decision in Castellanos?
It's certainly one factor to consider, just like all the others. This is a totality of the circumstances case. I think one important thing to recognize about Castellanos is that the crux of the reason, and I know Judge Murguia, you're familiar with the case, that the reasoning in Castellanos was that the prosecutor had given a reason for striking the challenged juror that was actually contradicted by the record. In sharp contrast, all the reasons that the prosecutor provided in this case, they're all supported by the record, Your Honor. So I think there is a distinction to be made. In addition, I think—
Do we know, I'm just curious, does this DA's office have any other history of VATS violations?
None that I'm aware of. In terms of this, do you mean the Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office or just this particular district attorney?
What do we consider at this point?
I think what's relevant is the specific prosecutor. And I think that comes out in the Curtis Flowers case, Flowers versus Mississippi, where the same prosecutor had repeatedly tried and excluded Black jurors. I think that case, you know, obviously extremely egregious by comparison. I also just want to point out, Your Honor, that one of the critical factors pointed to by the Supreme Court in considering these cases is the demeanor of the prosecutor. And here the trial court found no inkling that the prosecutor acted with discriminatory intent and that his reasons were not pretextual. Given that the Supreme Court has said that the best evidence of discriminatory intent is the demeanor of the prosecutor, I think that factor should be afforded great weight in this court's resolution of the claim.
So is one factor, if the court were to conclude that one factor is indicative of discriminatory intent, for example, the statistical analysis, is that enough under Batson? Can we decide based on one of the factors, or are you suggesting there needs to be more in this totality of the circumstances analysis?
It definitely has to be more, Your Honor. No one factor is dispositive at step three of Batson. At step one, the fact of statistical disparities can establish a reasonable inference, but it doesn't go so far as to show that race was a substantial motivating factor in the exercise of peremptory strikes against the challenged jurors.
Do you have a site for that? A case site to support that?
Well, I mean, I think the relevant cases would all just say that Batson at step three is a totality of the, I mean, Batson itself says that at step three, the court's inquiry is a totality of the circumstances inquiry.
But I mean, couldn't a comparative analysis alone sometimes be enough? I mean, if you have something very powerful, I'm just curious. You're saying that no one factor is dispositive. I understand the statistical might not be, but there could be a factor that would be dispositive. Is that not true?
So I should clarify, Your Honor. I mean that no one factor in this case is dispositive. So the statistical disparity, the fact of the previous finding of Batson error, those aren't dispositive in this case. In this case, the trial court or this court certainly needs to conduct a totality of the circumstances approach to resolve the claim. And so I think in light of
Are you all, I mean, as it sounds like everybody's in agreement that the prosecutor here struck either, is it 6 out of 7 or 7 out of 8 of the black persons who are on the veneer panel, is that correct?
Right, so it was 6 out of 7 informing the original panel and then 7 out of 8 once you include the alternate juror. That's, yeah, we agree on that. Yes, Your Honor.
And if there was a remand to try to determine someone's race, I guess either juror 3232 or juror 24,
31.
Yeah, 31. Would that be possible to determine that?
It might be, Your Honor. I can't say for sure. But I also, what I can say is that it's not necessary. It's not necessary.
I just wanted you to assume that maybe it might be, but I understand your argument that it might
So if one of those jurors is the black impaneled female juror, that would actually weaken petitioner's claim, because then petitioner would be comparing a challenged prospective black juror to a impaneled black juror. And this court in, I believe it's Cook versus Lamarck, stated that it's a weaker basis for comparative juror analysis when you're comparing a struck prospective juror who is the same race as a impaneled juror. So that's part of why I'm saying it's not necessary, because the only thing that could happen is either we stay in where we are now, which is that we're assuming that neither of those jurors, the impaneled jurors, are the black female juror, or one of them ends up actually being that black female impaneled juror.
But if neither of them are the black female juror, doesn't that bear some significance?
I would ask the court to challenge petitioner on why it does, because I don't see it, Your Honor.
Well, if and let's just say that they were both under the comparative analysis.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say, just assuming for argument that we disagree with you, that they do offer a significant comparative analysis. Wouldn't that have some meaning here?
The critical part of that, Judge Murguia, is you'd have to disagree with me that they are not similarly situated. Because, yeah, of course, no, my position is that they are not similarly situated.
No, I understand that.
So, yeah, I agree. If the court disagrees, then yes, okay, that would have benefit to the position that I'm taking. I agree.
Well, thank you, because that was helpful to understand your view on that. Let's see if Judge Malloy or Judge Beatty have any other questions for you. Okay. Ms. Hyde, I'll give you 3 minutes to respond. Thank Especially you. To that last question that I was asking, Ms. Attacker. Right.
Yes, we understand that the idea is that if we do get remanded for a hearing, it might weaken the current argument, but it would only do so, right, as he said, if one of those people happened to be the black female juror. The reason it's important to note that these both are provide such strong indicia of pretextual strikes is that there's more than one of them. So we know that there was only one black female seated juror. And given that both of these, both 2431 and 3232, have factors in their testimony or their discussion that the prosecution swears it was striking people for when they were black, just one of those jurors being not stricken, this is what Judge Malloy was asking earlier. The fact that one of those jurors wasn't stricken is enough you don't need to have necessarily more than one example of pretextual reasons or a reason failing or being weak. All of the issues are cumulative, I would say. They're not necessarily factors where one could be won and the other could be lost and some are more important than others. I think they're all cumulative. And so you have a number of strikes against this particular prosecutor already, the number of strikes, literally, sorry, and also his previous conduct in Castellanos. And then you get to the comparing these jurors and you see that these reasons start to fall apart. And there's no threshold for when they've fallen apart enough other than whether you believe by a preponderance of the evidence that the totality of his conduct gives you reason to believe that race was a substantial motivating factor in any one of his strikes. I wanted to also point out Kessler v. Cambra, because we keep talking about jurors 3448 and 8913. But Kessler, I think, did a good job of showing that we look at every single Black juror and every single non-Black juror to the extent relevant to our analysis. So, which is why I pointed out here also this concept of hardships, how I believe at least three of these Black potential jurors were let go for hardships, and then other jurors who had expressed similar or worse hardships were allowed to serve. So again, you know, that list of reasons that the prosecutor gave, he has to stand and fall by them. And if he was throwing everything at the wall to see what sticks, that gives reason to believe that he was looking for excuses to strike certain jurors.
Mike, can I ask you a question about the hardship analysis? So in my experience, the court will ask the prospective jurors, all of them, if any of them have a hardship or any reason why they can't sit. And then they'll raise their hands and then the court will go back and then ask follow-up questions to explore why they may or may not have a genuine hardship. And then decide which jurors to excuse. It seemed to me that that decision was more within the control of the discretion. Everything's within the control of the district court, of course, or the trial court, but that was more within the court's discretion in deciding hardship, and that the prosecutor, as I understand, was not asked to justify any hardship excuses, but instead was asked to justify strikes, peremptory strikes that a Black person's, and so was required to give an explanation to try to demonstrate that wasn't racially motivated. So I'm having a hard time, and I may just be completely wrong on this, so I appreciate your insight on it, but I'm having a hard time equating the hardship excuses with peremptory challenges.
Right. So what happened was that the prosecutor exercised his peremptory challenges, and then when asked why he struck them, he gave the reasons that they had given in their hardship analysis. So essentially, the court had reviewed, the court had heard their hardship stories and said, no, thank you. We think you still should serve. And then the prosecutor said, I struck them because of their hardships. So
okay. That's helpful. Thank you.
And so I think if that's all, I would just sum up by saying, you know, that as I said before, this is a case where all of these things add up. It's not that one factor is a winner or loser, but they all add up. And here our prosecutor had this history of discrimination and came here again with the same strategy of listing numerous reasons for releasing these jurors. When you actually review the record as a whole, you see that those reasons do not apply equally to Black and non-Black potential jurors. And that's what Batson is all about prohibiting. Thank you.
And there are any other questions?
No, right. But I would like to say thank you to counsel. They both did a really nice job. And I know that's Judge McGee's job as your presiding judge, but it's really a pleasure to see two attorneys do such a nice job in argument.
Thank you. Yes, I agree with that. Thank you both very much. It's very helpful to hear both of your oral arguments here today, and you were excellent in your presentations. The case of Kevin Maddox versus M. Elliott Spearman is now submitted. Thank you both very much. The next case